My name is Teresa DeGolier, and I'm from the Department of Biological Sciences. Going into a lab, what becomes important to me is that students see that science is not isolated. This is a time for them to work as a team. I feel quite strongly that they learn from each other, promote study groups, hopefully that they can use for their learning outside of the lab opportunity. And in many respects, what I can do is I can also look and see who's a potential TA, who's going to be someone that I can call upon to help students with tutoring. In preparation for a lab, what I'm often thinking about is this is an opportunity to turn on some students that don't learn in the more, what we would say is traditional setting in a lecture classroom. And this has been repeated over and over that the certain students who are in a lab, when they get involved with their hands, with computers, with technology, they seem to exhibit a much more freedom. And it lights a fire under what they're doing. And that is a huge hook for a lot of students who just can't learn as effectively from just listening or from just reading. I see the purpose of labs is an opportunity for students to understand that everybody doesn't know everything. I want to be able to empower them to learn how to find information. Labs can serve a number of purposes. It kind of depends what the objective is. Do I want to teach them how to use equipment? Do I want to teach them how to follow directions? Do I want to teach them how to assess data? Or do I want to actually collect data and discover for themselves some of the challenges that a scientist faces? Frequently, labs may overlap with lecture. Part of that redundancy is intended to be repetitive, because redundancy and repetition is retention. That's what it comes down to. Part of it is to promote learning that is not going to happen in a large number of students with me conversing back and forth. Labs are a wonderful opportunity for the student to collect data and assess mentally what's going on without me telling them what's going on. Hopefully I can kind of coach them. But I think the true purpose of the lab is to really provide a setting to enable the student to practice becoming a learner. Mm-hmm. Well, I feel quite strongly about this. Just because you have a lab setting doesn't mean you always run a lab. When you run a lab, one of the things you want to make sure you do is that you are modeling to the students organized thinking. If I am not prepared, if I do not know enough about the concept, I surely do not want to run a lab on it, because it will only tell them that this is a mess. It's not the behavior I'm trying to induce. When to run a lab, a very important characteristic to go with is to make sure that the potential for frustration in the technology is not greater than the learning curve. And usually tried and true labs have been done over and over, and you've managed to switch the balance so that the learning outcome is greater than what might be frustrating to them to make it happen. So equipment that does not work, concepts that are beyond their developmental level, those are all clues that is not the time to do a lab. Occasionally students ask to do labs that I say, no, I don't think that's ethical, or that's not the right question to study this, or that is too big of a question, and I have to simply admit, okay, this is a 100, 200, 300 level course. You're biting off more than we can answer, but it's a great question for a research institution or a summertime project. I think the best model is that they're a handshake. I'd like to see them, again, complement each other. If you have the freedom in courses, sometimes I love to make the lab the center of the course and use lectures as pre-lab content delivery and post-lab debriefing. What did we get out of it? But that doesn't always happen. Particularly in the sciences, a lot of the courses are content-driven because the intent is to prepare them for passing performance on a test or to meet test requirements to get into a career. So sometimes that freedom isn't there. But you can still take lecture time to reinforce lab concepts. And one of the gifts we have here is that we actually teach our labs, and frequently the same people that teach the lab are also in the same lecture. So there's that consistency that you can bring. In creating a new lab, it's to use a model that people have said before, I should be looking at their foreheads and saying, so what? Why am I doing this? What is the point of me doing this? Again, a lot of it is, what is my goal? Am I teaching them a protocol? Am I teaching them how to follow directions? Can I assess their outcomes as a means of, all right, they can think logically? Or am I really trying to teach them to act like a scientist? Do I want to give them enough information so that they can develop an experimental design? I need to be in a capacity to guide their thinking. How many samples do I use? What do I do for treatment? You know, is my goal to really prepare them to be researchers? Or am I preparing them to be discoverers? Not all science is neat and clean like experimental design as we think it is. A great deal of science is like, whoa, why did that happen? And try to process data. When I'm thinking about preparing new labs, it's usually in response to something I can't really get across in a classroom by verbiage or by reading. They really have to be part of the data acquisition. Again, tends to promote retention, tends to evoke a number of responses in students who are shy in class because they gain some confidence. And occasionally there are things they just are not going to pick up unless we get in the lab and demonstrate this and do this. And developing new labs sometimes is simply a hook to get them to think, to build these critical processes for what if. And it's not too trite, even though this is college, to say that you need to wonder about this. This is something that's taught in the elementary, but this needs to continue all throughout their life, is to wonder about why things happen as they do. Well, this is done to promote retention and use. Puts them in a good position of hiring because they're able to take data and make meaning out of it. What I found is most helpful is to give them actual examples, real-world examples of the data. It kind of comes in two places. I often give them examples that I've run across. This is what happened in my journey with this science. I've seen this, and connect them to real-world examples. And that usually triggers students to talk back and say, oh, this happened. Can I remind you of elementary school when they all want to raise their hands and tell you something? But they're making connections, and that's the goal. The other way is part of their lab reports take more of the story book. I shouldn't say storybook, more of the story problem, where they take data that they didn't necessarily collect, but they should recognize the format of the data and now try to solve the problem. So giving them examples, clinical examples, this is a pathology, this is what happened when this variable went off the scale. And then as groups with their lab homework, they go back and try to chew through, what do I do with this information? And just these exercises of redundancy usually help them to connect to real scenarios, particularly at this level. A number of the students in January and summer were really encouraging them to get internships where they may experience what it is they want to do as a career. And many of them will pick up on their course materials and go, you won't believe I did this. And I have a story about this particular patient that came in, and it matched the type of stuff we were matching in class. Mm-hmm. Well, a big piece of this is I hope to try to remove some of their intimidation. We do a lot of data collection with technology pieces. We pick up biological information, and we use computers to transduce it into signals we can read. We can have the computers measure it and do analysis. They still have to drive the thinking, but I want them to have that exposure, because not only is that what they're going to run into in their practice, in their industry, in research, but just to make them do it now. I really feel that those students will admit they're not going to know everything when they go into their career, but if I could remove some barriers, like I'm afraid of technology, or like I have no idea how to even turn on the machine, let's get past that and be willing to ask questions. Go ahead and make some mistakes, get some confidence in this, and pretty soon they become quite savvy because they are not scared of technology. So that would be a big piece in this course, is it's driven by the instrumentation. Learn how to use it, but everybody goes through a learning curve. Let's not be afraid of it. This can be your friend. It's going to make your, hopefully, your task easier. You can gather more data, and the wait time to interpret data will be reduced. Safety starts out with a very general introduction. In the beginning of the semester, we have lab safety contracts they all have to sign, which is general, you know, common sense. It's still written down. They still have to sign a contract. I remind them that they might not agree with everything. They still have to honor a contract, and that's just the way it is sometimes. You just have to go with the flow of people who have been there doing this longer, probably do know better what to avoid. A lot of the safety is on a case basis. If we have labs that deal with blood, for example, or body tissues, or needles, or sharps, things of that nature, is they need to be addressed ahead of time, what to do with them. In my mindset, it's kind of very much the Boy Scout, Girl Scout theme. You are always prepared. You are always over-prepared so that if something happens, you will never be caught off guard. So we do talk about things. What happens if somebody faints? What are we going to do if someone gets dizzy when doing an experiment? So they need to know the what ifs. And then I need to reinforce the policies too. When these things happen, I have to act on them, which means I need to be in the room. I can't take off for 10 minutes and go do something else. I'm watching, not so much babysitting, but being aware to perhaps stop something that doesn't need to happen that the student might be completely oblivious to. What I'd love to do is have the students do as much of this as possible, not trying to eke out my responsibilities or that of a TA. But if a student is setting up a lab, a student can usually fix it or troubleshoot it if something's not going as they should. How much I have students set up depends on who the group is and how long the labs are. If I'm looking at students who I, by nature of the course, are going to be doing research, I want them to put everything together. They need to become intuitive in a linear flow of how things get put together. If my goal is, nope, we just need to collect data and my goal is to interpret data, I'll probably have a lot of stuff organized and set up for them because I want the time to deal with that particular objective. Obviously, the more they know about how the experiment is set up, the better job they're going to do in interpreting their data. But you have to be realistic and look at the amount of time the lab is given and who is the population. Again, if the population is one that simply needs to learn how to do a technique or learn how to collect data, not setting stuff up may evoke a frustration curve, and that's not the objective of the lab. What you're about to see is a student lab on urine analysis. They're actually going to collect their own urine samples, and they'll be using the typical urine dipstick that you would see in a regular medical physical to look at normal constituents of urine. They'll also do a number of other parameters, which will introduce them to other machines, osmometry, the amount of other components in the urine that can't be measured by the dipstick. So there's some machines going on, there's a lot of conversation going on. They tend to be quite verbal about labs that tend to use body fluids. They have a lot to say about that. I have some goals as far as processes here because this is a lab we do towards the end of the year, and by doing this lab I hope that they integrate that how a body system like the elimination of waste really is the outcome of several functions. So it's a very integrated lab depending on what's happening with acid-base balance, respiration, digestion. So to integrate materials by the outcomes of the lab. They have a great deal of teamwork they need to do. They'll be working in groups on this, so there's some coordination that has to happen, and they should be able to do this in somewhat of a self-assembly manner. I will also give them an unknown sample of urine, which would mimic a pathological condition, for example, a diabetic or someone that's been starving themselves, things of this nature. What is their urine going to look like? Because components in your urine don't lie. So they will have to go and research why these components are in their urine, and then they each get about a 10-minute window to present the class what may have happened physiologically or behaviorally to create this. And then we'll close with, they'll have some lab report questions, which are kind of these storybook questions of, here are some examples of urine analysis where a pathology must be discussed beyond what we can do in the class. And then also they're going to take about 15 minutes to look at a DVD that is a very nice review of how your urine can tell you about your state of hydration, your state of acid-base balance, and it's a game actually called, and they win buffer bucks by guessing the acid-base disturbance. It's kind of fun. Now, we have to talk a little bit about what the purpose of the lab is. We're going to analyze urine samples. Could we just have a little hip hip hooray for your urine sample? Let's hold them up. Be bold. Here we go. Oh, the world is a carousel of urinary yellow today. Excellent. Excellent. Okay, do you have to go? If you can produce a little bit more, yes. Okay, now some of you are going, eee, that there's a vast difference here in the thickness. I shouldn't say thickness of the earth, density. And part of that may have been your diet. Part of that may have been your gender. Part of that may have been is your urine in the refrigerator. So we do want your urine at room temperature. So I think everybody does have their urine out who has produced a sample. Okay, wonderful. Way to go. Okay, what is it we're going to do? What it comes down to is there are four things that have to happen in this lab. Not all of them will happen today, but all right. First of all, is you're going to analyze your own urine. We are going to be positive that all systems are working according to their normal set of parameters, right? We want to make sure you're in homeostasis. Rest well. You are, or you would not be in here. So we're going to do a number of tests analyzing normal urine. That will take the bulk of the class period. Secondly, I'm going to give you an unknown. And the unknown is something wrong with it. The unknown is made up of artificial urine, so you won't have to handle somebody else's urine. This artificial urine, I have done something to it to create a pathological disorder. When you analyze that, you, and this is written on your lab directions, you are going to have to name the abnormal constituents, give me a name of this condition, and the pathology of why this happened. This will be kind of a group activity. For example, the four of you will take one on one as a group, spend about 10 minutes trying to answer those questions, and then we'll go one at a time and just basically say, what did you find? This person is not in homeostasis. What is the problem? Now, third is a bunch of questions. And I hinted in class yesterday, we spent about 10 minutes talking about diuretics. That's where you can put that information in place. That's something you can work on while you're waiting for everybody to kind of get caught up. All right. The fourth thing is actually a CD simulation. And what I've decided to do is I don't think we're going to quite get enough time to do this today. So next week, when you return for your quiz on urine analysis, we'll take about 45 minutes to do a simulation. And it's actually a lot of the stuff that we talked about in class on water acid base balance. It's kind of fun. It's called vein net acid base balance. I kind of hinted at it yesterday in class, but it's actually a game. It's a very good game because it's going to force you to prepare for your exam, first of all. But it will help a lot, especially some of the questions you were asking yesterday. This will be very helpful. It's going to animate some of those behaviors that we talked about. So this is actually the last part of your lab, but we're going to do this next week instead. So if you purchased your textbook from the bookstore, this should have been, maybe not with this cover, but the CD should have been attached to the inside back cover or the front back. Okay, now, let's go over what you have to do. So you need to give me about 20 minutes, I think, to walk through the instrumentation. So I want to try to walk through enough information for you to repeat the procedures and not lose time by understanding the machinery. This is well written, and you need to be reading this if you have not already. But what do we know about your own urine? First thing you need to do is describe physical characteristics. When you look at your lab report, the part that I prepared, opposed to the book part, you can see that there is a table. This table should replace the one that's in the manual. And this is where you're recording a lot of your information. On the column on the left are normal values. The column on the right is what is your specimen. You'll have to write answers here. Now, when you describe physical characteristics, these are no tests. What does it look like? Give it a color. All right? It suggests colors you might use to help you describe, giving you some reference point. Describe thickness. I mean, if we just, Amy, if you would just hold your samples up a minute, this is probably some of the extremes right here. This would be more of a color contrast, I'm sorry. That's very dilute, that's very concentrated. Gabe, if you would hold yours up, this is very dense. Okay, a lot of this is going to reflect what has been consumed in the diet. All right, so there's going to be a lot of differences. So you're going to have thickness terms to use, color, clarity. You should also describe smell. Now, here's where it gets tricky. How do you smell? You probably have done this in chemistry before. Just take the lid off and waft it into your nose. Nobody has to. All right? That is not necessary. All right? But you think about it. When you waft something, when you wave your hand over, you push some air particles out of the way. That causes some air to escape from the urine, carrying with it some odors. And all you have to do is let it stimulate your nose. It might be odorless. Amy, I'm going to guess that yours isn't even going to smell, and I'm going to guess that yours is. Okay? Because of the solutes that are in there. Now, do the best you can to describe what you think it smells like. Please don't say, my urine smells like urine. Okay, can anybody describe your urine smell?
ever we just do like strat or order lesser order.
Okay, that's helpful.
So.
Yeah. And especially if you cannot put your finger on an item. Now I can. I can smell my urine and go, Cheerios. I don't particularly eat a lot of Cheerios, but if you drink coffee, there's a tendency for your urine to smell like Cheerios. I see a nod. Yes, I hear an amen, right? So you can sometimes pick up on that. Okay, sometimes diabetics, their urine may smell like acetone. Certainly their breath does, but you're going to have to chase some of that too. So you can use smell sometimes to get an indicator what is being filtered through. But that's a good suggestion. If you cannot name something, at least say odorless or, you know, pungent or something. Right, but if you can actually smell something, that gives a better marker description, doesn't it? Okay, now, inorganic components. There are several tests here. We are not doing this multitude of inorganic component tests. We're only going to test for one of them. Nitrites, anybody? I'm sorry, that should be an I. Nitrites, anybody? Maybe from micro. Nitrites is an indication of what? Bacterial activity. Alright, if there's some bacterial activity going on, UTI, urinary tract infection or something like that, you might get some nitrates. This is going to be done with a Chem-9 stick, which are not in your bottles right now. Right now you just have empty bottles with the references on there. But that's the only inorganic component of your urine you're going to check. What we're mostly interested in is the organic. And if you just take a look for a minute at your vial here, just take a look at the number of things here that you'll be testing. We'll be looking at leukocytes, of course, white blood cells. Here's your nitrites. We'll get your pH today. Proteins, glucose, ketones, bilirubin. Now I'm going to clarify something here for a minute, and bilirubin and blood. Now, urobilinogen and bilirubin we're not as familiar with because they're going to show up in the digestive system, which is what we start tomorrow. So let me give you a little help here. Bilirubin, we hope is not in there, that's an excess of bile salts. That's supposed to be reabsorbed. Okay, so if that would show up, that would question liver function. All right. Urobilinogen is a breakdown product of, actually, hemoglobin. And it's likely you're going to have a little bit of it in there. Urobilinogen, along with another pigment called urochrome that you'll read about in the lab report, are what gives you your urine kind of a yellow color. You got a hint of brown in your urine color. A hint, not a dark brown, not a chocolate brown. Okay. If you have a hint of brown, it's probably the urobilinogen. Expect to have a little bit in there. It'll be normal. In fact, when you look at the key, it says normal. Okay, so you should have some of that. One shortcoming of this test is where it says hemoglobin. Actually, it says blood, and then notice that the blood tracing splits into two rows. It has various quantities of hemoglobin. This test is not going to differentiate to you if you're passing whole blood or if you're passing hemolyzed blood, blood that broke and split, and now you're passing hemoglobin or blood cell fragments, all right? This test is only going to tell you there's some blood marker going through. All right? Now, when you do these tests, the chem strip, what you'll be doing is, and I'll take this out, here we go. Just when you're ready to do this, take out a vial. I just want, or a strip. I want to point out a little bit the proper handling here. When you're not using this, please put the cap on because these will be, they'll get exposed to the air, and after a while they're going to react with the air, and then I can't use them anymore. And they're actually kind of expensive. They cost about a buck each. Okay. And remember, when you go to the doctor's office and do this, you usually get charged about $150, all right? So, obviously, they're getting paid for knowledge, which is where we're going with this, okay? Now, there is an end here, which is just plastic. That's the end you hang on to. And then there's a bunch of, like, felt tips. Each one of these has some sort of reagent, which will change color to indicate the presence of something abnormal or something normal. And so all you're going to be doing with your urine sample, if I could just hold on to yours as an example, all you're going to be doing is dipping this down, making sure all the pads get wet. All right, dip it down, take it out, and then just lay it on your desk right on a chem wipe. You have a timer on your desk, 1 minute. Don't read it before, don't read it after. Read it at 1 minute. Obviously, it's going to change a little bit after 1 minute, but don't read it much later than 1 minute, because they're built to go at 1 minute. If you do this for 5 minutes and then come back and read it, I would not trust the strip, because they will keep changing, but then you're going to get markers that are not intended to be read at 1 minute. How do you read it? You have your vial. It'll tell you where the plastic end is that you hold.
and just hold it up to normal, and then what you can do is scroll down and record what your values are. So on your sheet, you actually need to record these values. This can be thrown away when you're done. There's no point keeping this or submitting it in, because remember, as I said, the color paths will continue to change. And I don't want to misread something that isn't true. We should just have one of these per person, and then you can pick up one of these when you do the unknown. Because when you do your unknown, you're only going to use this strip test. Okay, they cannot be reused, just one time only. So get them good and wet. 1 minute, and then read them. So you may have to take turns. I have about two or three stopwatches per table. Now, a couple things. We will want you to talk about your values. I mean, you can write things down like negative, normal, or trace. Sometimes we may hit tests that are not really indicative of what's going on. There are substances that can be in your diet that can throw off the markers. For example, if you are on a lot of vitamin C, or if you are on aspirin, I think those are the two that really throw off your white blood cells. You know, they have different effects. They might actually give you a false positive. So if you're like, well, I'm not sick, I don't know why I have that. Well, it could be a false positive based on some other chemical that's in your system that's getting filtered in your kidneys. Your book gives you ideas. I can't remember if it's exactly the leukocytes, but one of these we often get false positives based on if someone has an aspirin consumption or a vitamin C consumption. So we should be aware of that if you get something showing up that you don't think belongs there. For those of you females, if you currently are menstruating, you are going to get a positive test on blood. Hey, that's the way it is. Why is this so important? Because if you were going to the clinic and you had a positive blood on your urine and the nurse says to you, are you menstruating? And you said, no. Ooh. That would be a very serious sign that you've got blood cells going through your glomerulus into the filtrate. And remember, how do blood cells fit through? They're not supposed to. Those slits are either destroyed, or this is a sign of an inflammation, right? So that would be deadly. So don't be offended when a nurse asks you that. If it's menstrual flow, oh, okay, well, that's expected. Because of the proximity of where blood flow and urine come out is so close, typical contamination. All right? So just keep that in mind. It's not an invasion of privacy in that sense. It's an indication to diagnose and discern what is in the urine that should be there or should not be there. Okay, so that's pretty straightforward. So again, physical characteristics, we'll get the inorganic components off of this. We also want to do urea nitrite crystals. Now this is kind of cool, you have to be a little patient on this. But what you're going to do here is you're going to heat up a drop or two of your urine on a slide. And while it's heating, it's going to react with a very strong nitric acid. And then we're going to look at it under a microscope. Now, here's how it works, okay? Up here in the corner is where some of the materials are. Your directions tell you exactly what to do, so I won't overkill that. But here's where the nitric acid is. It is very concentrated. Leave it here. Bring your slide here. Do not take the nitric acid back to your desk, all right? Then, what you'll do is you're going to bring it to a hot plate. Now, this is not so terribly hot you can't touch. It's about 55 degrees Celsius, okay? I don't want to leave my hand here. But you can put the slide on the edge, you know, the glass part that you hold, the frosted part you can put right here, and put it on the edge and let it start to dry. Now, you don't have to necessarily be here the entire time, but you should kind of know when you put this on and where you put it on. You don't want so much heat that it evaporates and sparks, right? What's going to happen is you're watching for the outside of your drop to start to evaporate the aqueous component, and you're going to form crystals. The crystals are quite pretty. They should be hexagonal or rhombus, and they may be very layered. Now, when you start surfing under the microscope and see these, and I think the scopes are kind of pretty well set. Low light. All right? You can play a little bit with the diaphragm and the light, but keep it low. Otherwise, these crystals are thin. You just sort of push the light right through them. You won't see them. But go towards the edges of the evaporative portion. That's where the crystals are. Because to make crystals, you already aware, is a slow process. And in the middle, you'll get these long streaks that look like lightning bolts. Those are not crystals. Those are crystal wannabes. We can save yourself a little time by looking at the first crystals that form, which will be on the outside ring. They're actually very pretty. So each person should try this. It's not a long activity, but you have to be a little patient. So we are testing for your urea You combine it with nitric acid, and what's resulting, the new precipitate, is a crystal that forms urea nitrate. So this could be a positive indicator of urea in your diet. Now, urea in your urine, right? Metabolite of proteins and DNA. If you have, let's make a little decision here. If you have really dilute urine, you're going to have a hard time finding urea crystals because the osmolarity is so low, right? So I would say between the two of you, probably it's in your best interest just to pick whoever has what would appear to be the cloudiest and darkest urine. Because you probably have more concentrated urine, you're more likely to get crystals to form. But if you've been pushing water big time, I'm not sure the activity is worth it. I would take the person then between the two of you who has either the darkest or the cloudiest urine. And then between the two of you, work on a scope. It is pretty neat. And I will help you here, but you should be able to see these well. Okay, now while all these other things are going on, there are some things that you can do anytime. And some of you should start these two activities right away because there's only one osmometer and there are only two refractometers. Refractometer will be for specific gravity. You have used these before when we looked at plasma proteins. Remember these? Okay, just as a reminder what we're going to do, you'll take with your pipette a drop of urine, place this on, don't let it splatter, and then, kind of hold this up with fingers and thumbs. Don't grab this like this. Hold this up with fingers and thumbs, and then look at a bright light. On the right is a scale, and that's what you're looking at. The scale markings go 0.00, and then there's a scale hash, so you should be able to write to the thousandths place. You get a really nice, you'll remember this when you do this, you'll remember it. It's a real nice, pretty blue screen, and then it's white when you line it up with. You'll remember this. You've done this with plasma proteins. But read the scale on the right. Scale on the left is plasma proteins. Did we do this day, the first lab?
No.
Yeah, did you do blood osmolarity in the first lab? We did blood cells and diffusion.
Yeah. Yeah, but we didn't do that.
Oh, what am I thinking of? Okay, stand corrected. Okay. Okay, let's let me draw a little picture here. Because this is really cool, but you got to do it right. When you look at this field of view, you'll need two scales in here, like a millimeter ruler's kind of. The one on the left, those plasma proteins. The albumins are in there. The one on the right is what we want to pay attention to, is specific gravity. Okay, what is the specific gravity of water? One, yeah. So guess what? Your urine's going to be greater than one, right? Nobody has a specific gravity less than one, because your urine is basically filled with water plus anything else that is not reabsorbed but is secreted, right? So we're going to get something above one. Our ranges are probably going to be somewhere between as close to distilled water as some of you are to maybe something 0.05, something like that. That would be one. So you're looking at small differences, but the way you'll see them is when you look at the screen, you'll get a mark. It'll be blue and white. But right now I can't remember if it's blue or white, but you get a separation in field. Where you have the color contrast, that's where you read this on that ruler. So it's very simple. You just have to point to a light. When you're done, you do need to clean this off. It's a rather sassy piece of equipment. Take an alcohol pad. Well, actually start with a Kim wipe and wipe off the urine. Then take an alcohol pad and wipe it off. And then just leave it cap up here so that it dries. I'm going to watch a little bit and make sure there's not a film building up there. And they're calibrated before class, so they are ready to go. So just again, Amy and Megan, if you would just hold up your urine samples again. Obviously, who's going to have the greater specific gravity? I can see it. You have clouds of stuff in there that are forming by sitting there. Good. And you really pushed water in order to create urine sample. Way to go. Okay, so make sure that you use common sense when you read your values too. Now, in the case of urine specific gravity, that's what this is, USG. When you get that value, put that on the board, because at the end of class, we have this big carousel of urinary yellow that we're going to use to see if your numbers make sense of what your eyes tell you. So put that value on the board. No units are required. This is taken at 20 degrees Celsius, which is approximately the temperature. Measurements students are, and then there's kind of like a line that connects these, right? Does this sound familiar? Now, you don't know what your osmolarity is. Excuse me, I said you're given unknowns. What if you're given a standard? These are the standards that I use before class. 100 milliosmoles, 290, which is basically what your blood is, all right, and 1,000. Really concentrated here. These were knowns. I put them on the machine and made a line, a regression line, I guess we should say. Now, you're going to come in here and pop your value in here, and you have no idea what the osmolarity is. But the machine will read some value on the y-axis, and then we'll just simply take that and go, oh, my, your analysis is 300. Have you done these types of things in other labs before? You take a curve that's been developed ahead of time with known concentrations, and then that's exactly what the machine is doing for you. So you're going to put your unknown in there, and the machine is doing all the work for you. All you will have to do is read and scale. Okay? Very easy. How does it run? It takes about 2 minutes for each person to do this. So kind of right away at the beginning here, some people should get started, because this would be kind of the limiting factor. Alright, like an enzyme step, this will be the rate limiting factor when we get done, because it takes about 2 minutes per person. What do you do? Pretty straightforward. You have a pipette tip, you have a little tweezers here, and you have a whole bunch of these very small little white discs. Try to take just one. Now, what you're going to do is we have a door right here. Right now the door is shut. You simply open the door, and it says open shut on there, and then pull this out. Now, on here is a little white frame. It's like a bowl where I put this disc. Now, what you do, grab a clean pipette tip, pull up some urine, put it right on here, and actually probably what I should do is just demo this for you. Can I do your urine? You can do it again in class, okay? So you want to unscrew that for me, because I haven't put gloves on yet. Thank you. So take a urine sample, and what you do is there's a little fork right here to help you hold this steady. Put the pipette right in here, dispense your sample, and you can actually, did you notice how I push down? You can actually push down. That makes sure that that little paper thing stays there. Now, push the door in, click this back to close, and you got to wait 75 seconds. It's counting right now, 73, 72. How do you get this off? It's a little different than some of the pipettes that you've worked with before. You actually have to lift off the top. So if I push off the top like that, that comes off. Just lay this here, and then you stand nicely and wait for 50 more seconds. Do not leave your station, okay, because people are going to be waiting to do this. But when you get your numbers, record that on here in the same place, the same line, where you have your specific gravity and where you have your pH. Those are the only values that you have to record in class. Because remember, we make a very large, sweeping conclusion before you leave today. This is your last activity we'll do as a group today. To make a comparison, again, for the second time now, color, specific gravity, osmolarity, and the release of vasopressin. Boy, there's like 20 exam questions right there in that concept. Okay, when the countdown is on, we're at 18. The reason I want to wait and walk through this is I want to show you how to clean your sample off. First of all, you will want a chem wipe. Not a Kleenex, we actually need this type of absorbent tissue. Woo-hoo! Your urine osmolarity right now is 195. Kind of makes sense to me because the color of your urine is a little dilute relative to what you usually see it come out as, right? All right. So, how do you clean this up when you're done? Again, you have to open the latch, mechanically pull this out, and all you do is you're going to take that little disc, just pull it in here, and dry this well. Make sure, and this is pretty forgiving, you can kind of put some pressure on here. Make sure this is dry. If this isn't dry, we're going to get a false report. And then the next person comes in and repeats exactly what we did. I will, as I said earlier, in my excitement, probably stop about every 10 values, and I'll put a couple of controls in here just to make sure that we are staying true to what the values are. These kind of machines tend to wander a little bit, so I will recalibrate if needed. So about every 10, or about halfway through the rest of the class, I'll probably interrupt some and say, I need 2 minutes just to check this. And if this door stays out for quite a while, it'll start to ring. So what I'm going to do is simply close it. It'll ring for a little while and then stop. All right? So there's your osmolarity. start only on your year. Lastly, we want to look for something called urinary sediment. And again, this, and again, I'm kind of modifying this as I go along a little bit, looking at your samples. Again, let's do this just one person per two of you, whoever has the darkest and or thickest urine. Because what you're going to do is you'll be prompted to put urine into these microfuge tubes, a given volume. Then we're going to stick them in the microwave. Oh, not the microwave, the centrifuge. Let's not put them in the microwave. This is all set up. Whoa, ready to go. Sure it is. This is all set up, ready to go. And I'll play with the lock here in just a minute. But this is set up for 5 minutes. So when you fill this up, all you have to do is go start. Now, this has places for 8 tubes, which is not quite enough for everybody to do this at once. So once it looks like it's almost full, let's just run it. You will need to remember either to put your initials on here so we know whose sample is who, or this particular one does not have numbers on it. You will need to put your initials on here. And of course, we always need to run them opposite, load them opposite. You are all told to put them up at the same height, which I can quickly look as 10 mLs. This is just to help control the spin in case we have an odd number. You've done centrifuge before, we have to have a balance. So you should, it's all set for speed, you just have to put 5, push it, but I will have to play with the lid here. It seems to have locked, but I'll deal with that when you get started. I think the recommended order would be to immediately get a couple people going on osmolarity and refraction, because remember, these are the limiting steps. But you can do physical characteristics, the chem strip, the microscopic materials, right? Of course, you're going to, I didn't finish explaining this, I'm sorry. You're going to spend this at 5 minutes to try to throw all the solutes to the end of the test tube, right? And then take one of your pipettes, take a slide, no stain required, look at it in the microscope. And what are you looking for? What you're looking for, and if you look at your lab report, on mine is page 626, but your version might have a different page. We're looking for this picture right there. It is 626. You're looking for something called organized or unorganized sediments. Let me translate that for you. Although those are appropriate urinary terms, what does that mean? Organized sediments are things that you make like cells. They actually contain organic material. You might have sloughed off squamous cells. Guys tend to have this more because the urethra is longer, so you're going to see more squamous cells in there. You might see blood cells, we kind of hope not. Or something called cast. Cast, you may or may not see, it's a little bit of a red flag. A cast are pieces of protein breakdown. And when they're inside your nephron, they want to stick to nephrons, so they tend to come up in the tubes. Usually you got to drink a little more water if you're producing cast. I have up here some colored pictures of cast. This is not color. So you might want, if you think you have a cast, you might want to take a look at that. The unorganized sediments are not biological materials that are breakdown products of metabolism. The unorganized materials are crystals. You might see uric acid crystals, and these are pretty good pictures. Probably the most beautiful crystal to see from your urine is calcium phosphate. That's that middle one, the bottom. It's going to look a bright yellow. I haven't seen them very often, but if I see one, I will get everybody's attention because they're very pretty. I doubt you're going to see cholesterol. You should see calcium oxalate. It has that nice pyramid-like look to it, uric acid crystals. Ammonium urate looks kind of fibrous almost. But this is these pictures here are pretty good sketches of what you see. Of course, they're black and white, and what you see is going to have a little more yellow tone, part of that simply the reflection. So, I think we're just about there. Let me recap the big picture. Your own. Because you haven't used this, and I thought you had, if you need help, don't hesitate to call. I'm just going to be surfing around the room a lot. All right? The unknown, I would wait to do this till the end. When you're done with all of these collections, then do the unknown, and I will give it to you. Please do not throw away the unknown. I would like to reuse them. All right, but just hang on to it. You can leave it in your test tube rack. Giving you a number of pipette tips to choose from if you want to use plastic ones or glass ones. Okay, So when are we done today? We're done today when all the data's on the board and we can do our big carousel of information. If you're done quite early, you have questions to work on. And they're quite good questions. They're very clinical in orientation. During this lab, you should be handling only your own urine. Please wear gloves. All three sizes are over there by the sink. After you have made microscope slides, and you know, I love you to do show and tell. Please pull me over when you've got a slide. Because sometimes we won't see everything because some urine's dilute, some urine, you know, we just aren't going to catch it. So if there's something really good, we'll probably want everybody to look at it. But I would like to see your slides, not just to help you focus, but maybe just to like go, yes, that's what you're looking at, or no, that's a water drop, or something like that. When you are done with your slides, in the corner is the sharps box. That's where the slides go. Where does your urine go? When we are done, everybody will kind of do this all together. When we are done with our activity, you can put all your urine back in your bottle and be done with it. Go back to the bathroom, empty the urine down the toilet. And then all you have to do is bring your collection bottle to the sink right there. I will, between classes, rinse them out with a 10% bleach solution. Okay? Technically, you could run your urine down the sink because it all goes to the same pump. But if it goes into a toilet, then I know what's been in the sink and what's not. So we'll try to control that. All right, there's nothing hazardous about your urine. I think just most people appreciate flushing it down the toilet instead of knowing it was in the sink here, right? Okay. Gloves, paper products, all that other type of stuff, anything paper, can simply go in a waste basket. Okay. So our activities will probably take about 2 hours. I'm cutting out this part till next week. But what is the signal again that we're all done? Everybody has collected all the data you need. We've gone through the clinical unknowns, and we've done our carousel of urine color. So nobody dump your urine when you're done collecting data. We do that at the very end of class. Good? Okay, let's go to it.
Oh,
that's sweet. Nope, that's right. That's where you put your drop on.
Oh.
Should be dry. If it's not clean, go ahead and wipe it off. But they should be good, because I cleaned them with your gloves.
Just one little drop?
Yep.
Oh, ew, it smells.
Yay! What does it smell like? You know, now I'm thinking about it, we probably shouldn't use that because everybody's going to want to use this. Use it for yours because it'll make everybody else just quite bad.
Okay.
No, don't throw it away. But I'll take them and get them out of this so they're not used, okay? Otherwise, we'll have contamination. Since you use such a small drop, it could be a variable. You can refresh me if it's blue or white at the top.
So where it changes, that's where you read.
Yep, you read the line flat and you read the scale on the right.
Yay.
It's at the very bottom.
Oh, it smells like
yeah. So you're not colored. So here's a case of a watch pot never boils. But what you're watching for are the edges, just the edges. And wait long enough so that before you might show. You won't want to use a part of it.
Oh, sure.
Ball, so
yeah.
You can wait a little bit more. You have values that you can put on the board, please do so. This is going to help me form my conversation based on what I see.
Cereals or coffee?
Sides kind of on an angle. Very good. Very nice. And that's just an affirmation. You have a lot of protein in your I'm sorry, not protein. You have urea, which is supposed to be in your
urine.
Amy, tell me about your vasopressin. Are you inhibiting it or are you releasing it? Because it's dilute, you're letting water go, you're overhydrated. So here's where you want to use this to try to avoid the metal content. You need to sweep it right off with a chemical.
Should.
It's really going to be a one-time shot like this. Presumptuous to me.
Yes.
Looks like you're about there. Okay, you see that? Good.
We need to know the clinical names.
Yes. And you can look all that up. It's in your lab report. The extra set of directions is all the clinical terminology. So you're in the process.
So
if
you guys did a... I was
on there.
How
about you guys? Was tested on a urine test strip. Nothing wrong. Now, you only had to do test strips, okay? This was tested on a urine strip. Nothing wrong. Okay, so I did the specific gravity. And the specific gravity was terribly close to water. So this is an extremely dilute urine. It's more dilute than anybody else on the board. So this person is pushing out a great deal of fluid. Where should my mind go with that thought? The more dilute your urine, the less what you're secreting. Yes. Now this is extremely dilute. This is following the normal diet. What's wrong here? What might be the problem? Person is not able to produce some of these vasopressins, so we do a check, we do an MRI, we find out they have a tumor pushing on their posterior pituitary. Okay, what do we call this person? Yes, what was it? Did you say diabetes? This is a type of diabetes. What does diabetes mean again? Large urine flow. But it's the large urine flow that doesn't taste sweet, where that like sugar diabetes. This would be the non-sweet diabetes insipidus. You want to go back to your notes on this. This is under the vasopressin. So someone that is not producing vasopressin, yeah, could be alcohol, right? Because that could suppress the release. Could be caffeine, there's a loop diuretic going on. In this case, I just fabricated it. It's probably a tumor that's causing the posterior pituitary not to make vasopressin. So this would be a person with diabetes insipidus.
Would it be possible if you have a tumor pressor in there for it just to affect the tumor?
Good question. Factor about take the symptoms out of my mouth. If the tumor is in the vase, if the tumor is in the posterior pituitary or in the hypothalamus, all right, it's probably interacting with several other nuclei of neurons that could have other effects. If it's pushing on the posterior, it's only going to affect two hormones. Because posterior pituitary only releases vasopressin and oxytocin. So that you could measure other behaviors of oxytocin if they're compromised too. Alright, so what you need to tell me is what you found in abundance, what's wrong. Here, the specific gravity was so close to water, made me suspicious. What is the name of the condition and what may have happened, both as far as a pathology or a behavior to induce this? Who's got A? Hey, talk. Here we go. These are good things for quiz questions. They are all in your lab report.
Our test strip came back with very high blood content and a high protein content.
Ooh. High blood and high protein. What are we going to call that? They have a number of conditions, don't they?
Well, it's a hematuria or hemoglobinuria.
Yeah, okay. How do we say those words? Say the abnormal constituent and add urea behind it. So hemoglobin, urea.
Okay.
Hemato is in reference to blood, so hematouria.
Hemato.
But you got it. You got the idea. Yeah. What do we call the high protein content? What proteins are not supposed to be in your urine? Albumin. So this would be albumin urea. Okay, so multiple names. This person, there's some nasty things going on. What do you think is going on?
Which would be albuminuria. And from what they said, we're going to guess ours is poison then.
Because?
Because there's no red blood cells, so it's not like kidney trauma or infection. It would just be, like, it's only the protein coming through, so it's not the...
Is it normal to sometimes have proteins go through?
Yeah. And this was like a ton.
Okay. So what? Well, is there? What I'm looking at is certain people for a short period of time may have proteins going through because of
pregnancy.
Yeah, in pregnancy, you've got a lot of extra capillaries. You've got a lot additional resistance. What's going to happen to blood pressure?
It goes up.
Yeah. And so if blood pressure goes up, the force, I'm going to now push a square peg through a round circle, that kind of thing. And it's usually temporal. It lasts for a short period of time, if it's pregnancy. But it could be a marker of high blood pressure. Honestly, we actually had a case like that a couple years ago where a guy actually had blood spill through the ear. We all wondered what's going on and sent him to the nurse, found out he had high blood pressure. Just had a change, a little bit of his diet modification under a lot of stress type thing. But again, the urine does not lie. And what would a man be doing with blood in the urine unless there was something wrong? Look at specific gravity, and let's just take some extremes here. Let's find the highest osmolarity. All right. Let's look at specific gravity. Let's find the lowest osmolarity. See a relationship?
Yes, we do.
What's the relationship? Do we see a relationship? It's not perfect, but it's a pretty good trend. The higher the osmolarity, the lower the specific gravity. Would that make sense to you? If urine osmolarity is high, that means you got a lot of solutes in it. It doesn't tell you which ones, it just says there's a lot of stuff in there. Correct? If there's a lot of stuff in there and you do specific gravity, that means that there's stuff in water. Specific gravity would be greater than water. So these people have high specific gravities. Here, low solute, low specific gravity. Now, is this the lowest specific gravity? Now, we want to take this a step further. Do you remember what I said? By the time you leave today, you need to connect four things. We just connected two of them, osmolarity, specific gravity. What are the other two? What is it? Teresa, vasopressin, and that's a third one. Color. Okay, now here we go. What I'm going to do is this. Everybody gets a piece of white paper. On this white paper, you're going to have to hold up your urine jar like this. Okay, you're going to hold it up nice and high. And below where you hold it up, in this order, because we want to watch this trend, in this order, would you, in dark bold-faced letters, you have large pens to write with, dark so everybody can see, would you write first your UOSM, and you can write that down, write your value, and then right below it, write your USG, urinary specific gravity. So put that at the bottom. Osmolarity, specific gravity, provide the labels so people aren't confused. And then what we're going to do is we are going to organize ourselves. We're going to make a very big circle. And starting right here, this open spot is going to be Gabe, the highest osmolarity. Start to go into formation. Assemble like a plasma membrane. You do this all by yourself. All right, I'm looking to see if we have this nice carousel of color going around. If you are organized by osmolarity, you would predict the more solutes would make your urine darker, right? More particles. Who knows what they are, but if there's more of them, it should be darker. That trend with color is pretty good, isn't it? A couple of you, who's on a multivitamin? Okay, I don't see it real well here, but sometimes if your multivitamin has a lot of vitamin B, it'll give your urine almost a fluorescent orange color, not orange, yellow. Kind of, it's not really bright. It's kind of like, ooh, that's so pretty. Okay, that's often a metabolite of vitamin B, but I don't see anything really strong jumping out at us. Okay, so first of all, you are organized by decreasing osmolarity. And the color code is not bad. It's going to be real hard to discern on some of these, but we would surely agree that it gets lighter as we go. Isn't that cool? You're pulling, say this, yes. You're pulling all those things together. So now you've actually collected biological data to support what we've said in class. Hooray. You have done a terrific job. Okay, now a quick reminder. How do we get rid of stuff? go to the bathroom and dump it in, then just put the jars in the sink and that's all. Don't wash them or anything, just leave them there. Then, kind of do the tidy up room thing. Make your station kind of look like it was. Slides in the slide box. Well done. Hoorah.
Yeah, I'll take the well first because that's exciting. I think what worked very well is they were prepared. And so there was less time that had to be spent backing up and waiting for everybody else to participate. So they were well prepared. There was an excitement in there. One of the things that was really positive, I thought, is they make a nice connection now to some of their next courses in nursing, which will be pathology and pharmacology. So they're not just analyzing their own urine, they're analyzing abnormal constituents. So they made this big connection between normal physiology and abnormal physiology. So that was good. And they'll tend to remember this kind of lab because they all felt kind of silly about collecting urine and everybody so covertly carried it from the bathroom into the lab wrapped up in paper, and by the time the lab was done, there are, you know, hip hip hooray for the production of urine. So they got meaning out of it. I think they'll retain it. Parts that I would improve upon is my awareness there was some instrumentation that I thought they had used. I still think they had learned how to use some of these instruments, but they just didn't practice it very well. So I should have not made the assumption that they would remember how to use a piece of instrumentation from previous in the semester. And that really didn't throw off the momentum, but it did kind of make me go back and like, why don't they remember this? What didn't they use it enough? So going back and kind of reevaluating some of the directions as far as instrumentation. Well, directions can come in a number of ways. Ideally, we would hand out something ahead of time, pull something on Moodle, for example, that they can read. That still does not substitute for something that's an oral discussion before we go. And then, of course, that direction can take a number of ways. If your objective is, I really want them to learn how to use a piece of instrumentation, then directions are, can you follow directions? And what you get when you run the equipment, the outcome of that is a measure that, okay, they're learning how to read and follow directions. But on the other hand, there are times, particularly later in the semester, where I'm going to give less directions and say, okay, you're getting quite intuitive how to run this program. Here's the question I want to ask. You figure out how to run it. So you can take more of the, I don't want to say it's a backseat. It's not really a backseat on my part, but it's letting them take the initiative in developing the process. So it's more of the guided inquiry type concept where I'm not going to give you the directions. Here's a question, or here are some questions. How would you go about answering this question? I think that's a wonderful way to teach, but I also feel strongly it's not the very first activity in the classroom, because if you don't give them enough guidance and inquiry, too many students aren't ready to do that, and they become frustrated, and they say, what was the point of this? But as they learn the process, and they learn how to think logically, how does a scientist think, they become very excited when you give them that license to do it. And then they'll ask good questions, and then the growth curve is wonderful. And it's not really less work on my part. It's a lot of joy on my part because I can see them grow. I can see them learn. But it's much more listening and remembering not to always talk. Let them stumble in a manner that will enhance the learning, but catch them before, like, oh, no, they can't go in that direction. That's not what we're after, and kind of coaching them how to go. But that seems to me the guided inquiry. The lack of what they perceive as direction happens later in the semester. They have to learn how to think to work with what your objectives are first. A big piece for me is to really keep them on track. And really the best way to do that is I need to move around the room with them. Watch what they're doing. And now here there's kind of a fine balance. I don't want to squash their energy. But at the same time, I want them to know that I'm aware of what's going on. I don't want them doing Facebook, email. Sometimes they're online because they actually have to find information about the lab. But to keep them on track, to ask them questions. If I'm walking around, they will usually ask me questions. They say, hey, is this kind of what I'm looking for? And I tend to not want to just say yes or no. Kind of the trick is, well, answer their question with a question. And so that's kind of forcing them to think about the data they're collecting and not just presuming that because they collected data that it's always the right thing. Always trying to get them to think, now, does what you collect, your numbers, agree with what you should intuitively get in? and that can help them discern a little bit about, am I making a mistake with my protocol? And equally important is when I'm collecting viable data, what does it mean? So a big piece is moving around the room with them and kind of focusing, keeping them on track. They work in groups, so it's very easy for them to get on the edge of silly. And there's nothing wrong with having fun in the lab. That promotes their learning too. But not at the cost of a poor use of their time. So it's a very much engage with them while the lab is going on. Yeah, a lot of the on-task behavior is to get them to talk about their data before they leave the classroom. In the labs we're doing frequently, we can write data on the board. And I wanted to get them to write the data on the board as soon as they collect it, because two things happen there. One, I can look at the data and go like, ooh, what's happening here? Like, yep, they're getting answers that I know they should be getting, so they're following directions. They're actually, the protocol's working. But at the same time, if they're putting data on the board, they're forced to look at the other data on the board and go like, why doesn't mine fit that? Or like, oh yeah, I'm kind of falling in the pattern. Then they start getting excited, and they start getting engaged with the rest of the class. So a big piece of their on-task behavior is to keep them physically involved. And part of that is when they're working in groups, it could be anywhere from 2 to 4 people. So you always want to make sure that somebody is doing something. Nobody should be left behind doing nothing. So we have a person who's scribing the information. Someone's usually the guinea pig. Someone's actually articulating to the rest of the group what the directions are. Someone could be running the equipment. So to keep them on task, they need to stay engaged, make sure everybody has responsibility. A little bit of that is a luxury, because it all depends how much instrumentation you have. But when you can control the size of the group, it's a much better learning scenario for everybody. Mm-hmm. Most of that would be also in addition to kind of parsing out what the jobs are and telling them up front, you know, you have groups of three for this reason. You're going to need someone to collect data from. Somebody has to actually run the computer program. Somebody has to be coaching the behavior. If there's groups of two or groups of four, that puts more responsibility on them. When there's groups of two, when there's groups of four, I just try to make a point. Why do we have groups of four today? So they kind of know what their involvement should be. Also, what's very important in keeping everybody involved is the next week tell them to switch partners. They shouldn't go through I shouldn't say switch partners they're working with. I do like them to be consistent with who they're working with. That's part of their development as teamwork. But switch responsibilities in a group. If someone's been the person scribing the data, they really should be looking at the computer program next week. Or if someone is a person who's the guinea pig and sitting there having biological signals recorded, they should be doing something else. Otherwise, we get someone go through an entire semester and they've never turned on the computer. And I think, oh, you really missed something here. And they haven't developed that skill set of getting past pushing on the button, or how to sit still, or how not to create artifacts because they didn't know how to behave during experiments. So they need to switch roles every week as well. A little bit of that concept is redundant a little bit when you think about what a lab is going to be too. Because how you're going to assess them in a lab report may depend on what your goals are. For some classes, especially if the labs are a little bit shorter, you're going to give most of the introduction and the methods in a handout or something assigned for them to read ahead of time. And then they have the methods there to guide their process. And so probably what you're most interested in is what is the data you collected? What did you do to the data? How did you analyze it to make sense out of it and now interpret it? So it's really focusing on the results and discussion. I'd say the majority of labs are focusing on that because that's the time constraint you have. If we're looking at labs that have a smaller number of groups and a larger amount of time, I'd like them to write up the introduction and the methods, because chances are when you have smaller groups, you can have more unique lab settings, and every person has a slightly different question to answer. Therefore, they need to translate what did I do methods and why. What was the significance of my methodology? What question was I trying to answer? So then you're looking at a longer lab report, but you're looking at a more thorough understanding of the process that you've completed. If you can use TAs for grading, that is great. When you do that, I feel you have to give them objective criteria to grade, which means either questions that you feel pretty good that they can make a good judgment call on, or that simply there is a right or wrong answer. There are questions I don't expect TAs to always know, simply because I may have changed what I did last year. If they're in a course last year, they may not recognize the question. And I don't really want to grade everything twice. Sometimes they grade things like, oh, well, actually, that's a right answer, but they didn't recognize it. So there's a piece of that. If I'm going to use TAs to assess, I kind of like to handpick my TAs. Someone who's had the course before, who I have seen has really grown and can integrate their ability to not just recognize a right answer, but connect back to the student who's going to read the assessment. Any assessments that are more subjective, I feel I really have to do, mostly because more feedback is required. Therefore, what kind of assessments I look for or how I'm going to evaluate them is going to depend on, to a certain piece, how much time I'm going to give. I do think the essay and short answer are probably the best way for me to interpret how well their content, their assessment of content and understanding is. But at the same time, if I can't turn around within a week, I don't want to create a frustrating situation for the student because they won't remember why they did what they did. They may get frustrated with constantly doing written assessments that are more essay, and the feedback is not coming back fast enough. And the last thing you want to do is frustrate them when you've asked them to write this voluminous amount of information. A big piece about processing is to make sure that they don't leave that room without understanding why they just spent 2.5 hours there. So it's not just the collection of data, follow directions. It's a bigger piece than that. What did I do in this room for 2.5 hours? It's that whole so what piece. So there must be a debriefing. Just like you have a briefing up front, make sure that they're coming in, zooming in to the point that we're going to do, what's the objectives. They must leave with a sense of what did I accomplish this hour. And hopefully it's more than a frustration curve. You must make sure, even if things didn't go as you did, there's always something to be learned from that. Why didn't that happen? Is the data we collected reflect meaningful data that explains a system or a process or an objective? Or is there something to be said about the learning curve and doing research? Why do we keep searching again for these answers, these truths we're trying to find? So there must be a debriefing period. Otherwise, I feel the student leaves the room and there's a high risk of retention just being very poor, because they won't have claimed ownership on what they've done. Oh boy, yeah, and it's just such a nice place in life to be if you've done the lab several times before. So some of what I've learned is just be ready. You have to put the time into it to be ready. Usually that means you have run the lab before. Sometimes that's not always a gift, pending, especially if you want to tweak labs and say, I want to add a factor here, but it's really a lot of time to actually run the lab. You got to know enough about what you're doing so that you don't create a higher frustration for the learning curve than you do for the content you want. So be ready, be organized, be on time. I think the students are very frustrated if you expect them to be there, and I'm not ready to start at 11:15 because I haven't finished the preparation, or at whatever time the lab starts. So be organized, be ready. Make sure the equipment does work. It is time consuming, but make sure everything works before you get there. Labs are a wonderful opportunity for students to engage learning that tends to have a much higher retention, and they will also retain frustration if that's all they get out of the lab, and that's not the message you want to send. Immediately, keep talking with the students during class. Do not be satisfied with just a collection of data, but constantly engage them with the interpretation of data. Again, a little bit of fine line here. Don't frustrate them by creating too much mental stress. For some, just collecting the data will be a big piece right there, because they're being challenged to assess things they haven't really been comfortable with before. Always looking at their own physiological parameters, saying, is that normal? Is that normal? Well, don't scare them off. Make them think through things. But a big piece of it is, have I done my homework? Do I know what kind of outcomes they're going to get? So that when they say, is this normal? Is this normal? I can encourage them. We're collecting data to understand. And give them that coaching. I probably have softened a little bit on this. I think there is a role for virtual labs, but it has to be a well-defined role, because I do not think the virtual labs can ever truly substitute for what a student will gain by the hands-on engaged experiences. I have used some simulations for reasons such as if I feel that this lab is really something that's going to cause stress to an animal, for example, more than I really need to do. Could they get the outcome from a virtual lab rather than like, wow, why is this a stress? So that may be a factor. Time commitment is an issue. There are labs that we'd like to do, but they take 4 to 5 hours, and a virtual lab can do the same thing, but they'll have time lapse, so I can condense the waiting period for an incubation to happen in 60 seconds instead of 60 minutes. So that is a good point. Occasionally there are labs that you'd like to do, but you really don't have the equipment, particularly if it's a lab you want to do in groups rather than a large demo. And in that case, it's still better for them to have a virtual lab because they're more engaged with the process itself. Occasionally, there are labs that are somewhat sassy and maybe above what I would consider the sophistication of the student at that point in time to do, yet there are components that they could get out of that lab. Also, just simply the lab size, too. Sometimes there are good questions and lab investigations that could be done, but they should not be done with, 12 groups of people. I could not possibly watch enough what's going on, not to reduce it to babysitting, but the point is, it could be pretty demanding, and it would be not safe to have 12 different labs going on where I really need to have my eyes what's going on. So I can see a role, especially as education becomes more online and distance learning, but I still strongly, and I've said this to students over and over, if I can do the lab, we will do the lab. If we have the equipment, if the ratio is good, if it's a lab where I just don't think the actual doing the lab could possibly substitute for watching a film on it, we will do the lab.